What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous video of this series, we saw how we can retrieve the minimum number of coins that produces a certain amount given different types of coins with different denominations. Today we are going to tackle a different aspect of the same exercise. So suppose we are given an infinite supply of different types of coins, such as $1 coins, $2 coins, $3 coins, etc., along with a certain amount. Now, what we must do is find the number of ways in which we can produce that amount given the coins we have. As an example, let's take the coins 2, 3, and 5, along with an amount of 10. Remember, we can use as many $2 coins as we want, same for 3 and $5 coins. Now, to generate that amount, we can use 5 $2 coins, right? Or 2 $3 coins with 2 $2 coins, or one of each of the coins, or 2 $5 coins. So, the total number of ways to produce that amount given these coins is 4. That's our answer, right? Okay, to solve this problem, we can use recursion, and with every recursive call, we can assume that for each coin we have two options, either pick or not pick that coin, by adding it or not adding it to our current cumulative amount, and as soon as that amount is equal to the target we are looking for, we increment the number of ways or result we want to return. However, we already discussed on several occasions the drawback of doing that. A lot of these calls are going to be re-invoked and the same recursive calls will be repeated over and over. The solution to this is to make use of dynamic programming. So let's get to it. Now, the trick here is to find the sub-problem we want to solve. You see, as with recursion, DP will attempt to solve a smaller problem at hand first and then build its way to the target we want. And the sub-problem here is to make use of these coins to find sub-amounts leading to the final amount we want. Meaning, if at a certain point we deduce that there are 3 ways to make up the amount 8 using these coins, and we know that jumping to a result of 10 will add a single way to these 3, making a new total of 4 ways. So, let's write down all the coins we had in the previous example, alongside all the amounts leading up to the final amount you are looking for. By doing this, we divide our problem into simpler sub-problems. Here, to fill the first row, we need to consider that all we have are $2 coins. And the first column in this row is basically asking ourselves, can we produce an amount of 0 with the help of $2 coins only? Yes, we can. And there is only one way to do that, do not pick any coin. And that will always be the case for the 0 valued column. Now, can we make a sum of 1 with the help of $2 coins? No, we can't. Can we make a sum of 2 with the help of $2 coins? Yes, we can, and there is a single way to do that. So here we won't be able to make odd values, but there is only one way to produce even values if all we had was $2 coins. When we move on to the next row, we are now saying that we can make use of both $2 and $3 coins. And a simple way to start filling these columns is to check if the coin value is bigger than the sub amount we are currently checking. If that is the case, then we just copy the value above it. In this example, 3 is bigger than 0, 1, and 2. Then all these 3 values will remain the same. Now, when we reach the amount of 3, this rule can no longer be applied, so what we do is take the value above it and add it to the value located in the same row under the column amount minus the coin value. So, in this case, we will have 0 plus the value under column 0, which is 1, making a total of 1 way to get that amount with the help of these 2 coins. Next is 1 plus 0, then 0 plus 1, and so on until we find the whole row. Okay, when we add the $5 coin, we can automatically copy all the values having an amount less than 5 to that row. And as soon as we reach the amount of 5, we must apply the same logic we previously did. So we will do 1 plus 1 equals 2, meaning 2 ways to get the amount 5 using all 3 coin types. We will keep doing this until the whole table is filled, and as you can see, the very last number located in the last row, last column of this table, is the result we are looking for. And as expected, that number is 4, meaning 4 ways to get the amount of 10 using these 3 coins. Now, implementing this solution will be very straightforward as it reflects exactly what we were doing. So, we will start by initializing a 2D array, which is the table we had. We added an extra column to the amount because, if you recall, we also have to take the 0 amount into consideration. Now, as we previously saw, the first column will always be filled with 1s, so let's do that. Next, because each row depends on the value stored in the row above it, let's go ahead and first attempt to fill the first row to use it as a reference for the others. So we are going to go over all the amounts we have, and if the value of that amount is smaller than that of the coin, then we simply have no ways of getting it and 0 should be filled. Otherwise, we apply the simple formula we discussed and add the number of ways located at the subtracted sub-amount from the coin amount we have in that row. After doing this, we can apply the exact algorithm we discussed by going over the remaining coins and the remaining amounts. So, we check if the coin value is bigger than that of the amount, then we copy the value above it only. If not, we add to that value the one located in the same row where the colon is equal to the amount minus the coin value, which is the remainder after taking into consideration that coin. When this is done, we can return with last value we calculated, which is the number of ways we are looking for. Okay, this is great. By doing this, we managed to solve the problem at hand while using a DP approach, which is awesome. And if you manage to do that, a follow-up question to this could be to try and reduce the space complexity used as much as possible. You see, this solution works, but it is using a 2D array, making our space complexity quadratic. Let's go ahead now and see how we can reduce this complexity to use 1D arrays. So, if you take a closer look at our algorithm, you will realize that we do not need to store all these values, because let's say we are working with the row tied to the $5 coin. At this moment, all we need is the row tied to the previous coin, which is the $3 coin. We have no use for the $2 coin row anymore. So, if we manage to keep track of the current coin row and the previous coin row only, we are set. That is all we need. And to do that, we can fill the first row in the same exact manner we did, but this time instead of filling a 2D array, we are going to put these values inside a 1D array named prev. And in the second part of the code, we are going to initialize the next array. And with every iteration, this array will be filled with the help of the values present in prev array using the same exact formula we previously used. As soon as an iteration ends, the values of the next array will be pushed onto the prev array, as these values will now be used to fill the array of the next iteration. And that's it! We managed to reduce the space complexity of this algorithm from quadratic to linear. Now, reducing the space complexity further is a bit tricky. And to ease things a bit, let's visualize the two arrays we had. And let's suppose we are calculating the value in red. You see, as soon as we fill a value at a certain index in the next array, the value located in the same index in the prev array is of no use to us anymore. So why not override it with the value we just calculated instead of storing the new one in another array? If we do that, we will be able to use the same array as our prev and next. And if all we have is a single array, that's what our code will look like. Everything remains the same, except for the condition we had in our nested for loops. You see, it is unnecessary to check if the amount is smaller than the coin value and put it in the array again, because it is already there, it is the same array. So, we can get rid entirely of this condition and instead directly initialize the inner for loop at the coin value. This way, all the values before it will remain the same in the same array, ready to be used. But wait, that is not the end of it. This can be further improved by merging these two for loops together, because now we can do that. This will result in the final solution you can see in front of you. The link to the lead code exercise we solved today can be found in the description below. Let me know your thoughts and suggestions for upcoming videos in the comments section. And that's it for today. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.